Chapter 10, The Fighting Illusionist. Sarah attacked, but Joe noticed immediately that there was hesitation behind her movements. She was slower than she should have been, and where a fighter might sometimes feign that they were slower than they actually were to draw their opponent in, Joe could tell that that wasn't the case with her sister. Sarah reached the calm and unassuming Monty and unleashed a flurry of quick blows in rapid succession. She twisted on her heels and toes, putting the momentum of her spin behind her attacks. Monty seemed completely unconcerned. Monty stepped nimbly, reaching up and deflecting each strike easily, and then moved to counterattack, turning in place much like his opponent, launching off a punch and then sweeping a kick. Thankfully, Sarah anticipated that a counterattack was coming, knocking Monty's fist to the side and then ducking beneath his foot and leg. She twisted in close to him, swinging an elbow at his back, but he ducked as well, beneath her strike, turning on his heel and sweeping Sarah's legs out from under her. Sarah tumbled back. She barely had time to react, her instincts saving her. She used the momentum from her fall to roll backwards and then spring up in an instant. She lashed out, but Monty ducked beneath her strike, grabbed her arm, and rolled her over his shoulder, throwing her several feet, leaving her tumbling out of control. Sarah had less than a second before she would hit the ground, but to an enemy like Monty, that second was like an eternity. Someone with the ability to create an aura could use it to turn themselves in midair and propel themselves back to the ground, or out of the way of the attack. But Sarah didn't have that luxury. She had to let Monty lunge at her back and strike twice in succession. She was propelled forward further, landing hard and rolling even further. Sarah was dazed, but she didn't waste even a second before pushing herself shakily back to her feet. She turned to face Monty, expecting him to be right on top of her, aiming to press his attack. But he wasn't. Sarah was surprised to see that he was waiting patiently. She scrutinized him, and despite herself, she asked, "What are you doing?" "We are having a heart-to-heart," Monty replied simply. "Heart-to-hearts have rules. Unlike my ally, I don't take undue pleasure in fighting. I can restrain myself until it's clear whether or not my opponent can go on." "I don't need your charity," Sarah spat, and she lunged at Monty again. This time, it wasn't hesitation that restricted her, but hastiness. Monty deflected her strikes, just as effortlessly as before, and knocked her back with a palm strike to the chest. "I'm sorry," he told Sarah calmly in a tone that made it difficult to tell if his apology was sincere or not. "But you really do." Sarah charged at Monty again, but by now, she'd cleared her head. She approached her opponent with his previous movements in mind. She feigned to the right, then twisted back inside his guard when he raised his arms to defend. She swept with her leg, but Monty hopped over it, so she sprang back up and threw a flying spin kick to the side of Monty's head. He ducked low again, just like he had to avoid her elbow. Sarah had predicted this, though. She dug her heel into the ground mid-spin to cancel her momentum, then snapped her other heel downward. She was aiming for the small of Monty's back, but unfortunately for her, he had anticipated her movements as well. Monty turned on his heel, avoiding Sarah's attack by inches. As he turned, he straightened up again and slipped out of his vest. He held it like a noose and used it to ensnare Sarah's foot, pulling it up against his body. He dropped the vest and grabbed Sarah's leg in one hand as he brought the elbow of his other arm down on her knee. From the sidelines, Joe heard a pop, and her sister uttered a yelp of pain. Monty let go of Sarah's leg and allowed Sarah to stumble away from him, hopping on her uninjured leg. After taking a moment to collect herself, she planted the foot of her injured leg on the ground as well, trying her very best to appear as if she was okay, but no one could miss how badly she was shaking. Monty stepped back as well, turning to face off with Sarah again. He was completely unharmed, and he wasn't even breathing heavily. He had outmaneuvered Sarah at every turn. Despite his age, he had the demeanor of someone with decades of experience. Every move he made was so precise that it was scary. He hadn't shown any indication that he was anywhere near as strong as Lawrence, physically speaking, but he seemed like he could dance circles around Lawrence with a little effort. Watching the fight, Joe couldn't be sure if Sarah actually stood a chance. She didn't know about Sarah's weakness, but she could guess how much damage Monty's attack had done to her sister's leg, and she would have bet real money that Monty, like Lawrence before him, wasn't giving this fight his all. Joe almost advised Sarah to surrender, but she couldn't bring herself to do it. This was shaping up to look like a life-or-death situation. Joe knew that backing down in the face of something like that would break her sister. She knew, because it would break her as well. So instead, Joe held her tongue and watched as Sarah took up her fighting stance again. Monty frowned just enough that it seemed like maybe he'd been hoping that his opponent would back down, but Joe didn't notice that. She was too busy wondering how Sarah intended to fight with just one good leg without an aura to empower the other. Luckily, Sarah had been wondering the same thing, and she'd come up with an admittedly stopgap solution. She concentrated and forced all of the soul flowing through her body into that leg, strengthening it. She put her entire weight on the leg for only an instant to test that she could use it again. The joint was still damaged, she could feel that it was, but her soul was holding the damaged parts together. She smiled and surged forward, stepping on Monty's dropped vest as she passed where it had fallen. Monty was momentarily caught off guard, and Sarah took advantage of that, springing up and sending her soul-charged knee sailing toward his chest. Monty managed to hold the knee back, just barely, using both hands. While his defense was preoccupied, Sarah lashed out with both of her hands, hammering Monty in the sides of his head. He stumbled back, and Sarah pressed her attack, throwing a front kick with her entire weight behind it right at Monty's jaw. He only had time to lean back, but even then, Sarah's strike still hit him in the mid-chest, and Sarah was already prepping for a follow-up. Monty was in a rough spot, and he knew it. That's why it was so strange when he smiled. Just before Sarah could kick him again, Monty disappeared. In his place, hanging in the air at about eye level, was his vest. Sarah kicked it out of the air and barely managed to keep from overextending and injuring herself further. She heard footsteps behind her, turning just in time to see Monty bearing down on her. He'd somehow switched places with his vest, and now, as he spun in place, slinging another kick at his opponent, he held his right hand out at his side and a straight black stage magician's wand sprang from within his sleeve into his waiting fingers. Light billowed at the tip of the wand. Monty pushed Sarah back using only his offhand, spun in place, and brought the wand to bear on her. A pulse of raw soul shot from its tip. Sarah deflected it off the back of her hand and spun in place, backhanding the wand to the side as well. As she spun, despite the pain that it caused her, Sarah drew upon the soul keeping her leg working and pumped it into the air around her. Sweat, tears, and even a bit of Jen and Tucker's blood, as well as a portion of the vapor that could always be found there, condensed around her hand and wrapped her fingers. She slung it at Monty like a whip, but he stepped to the side and jumped back and away from his opponent. She retracted the water whip, condensing the water further around her hand, creating her super-dense, icy iron knuckles. Sarah squeezed even more soul from her leg, ignoring the sharp jolt of pain that came as a result, then gestured with her other hand. More water was pulled from the air, splashing along the ground between her and her opponent. She bore down on that water with the force of her will and formed it into a thin sheet of ice, sliding on it toward her opponent at high speed. Monty, however, had managed to regain his bearings. He held his wand up in front of him and passed his other hand over it. The wand changed into a bouquet of flowers, Monty gesturing with them, and they unfurled into a flock of small birds that flew right at Sarah's face. Sarah flinched away from the animals involuntarily, but just before they would have hit her, they disappeared, leaving behind puffs of smoke that clouded her vision. She reached the end of the sheet of ice that she'd made with her soul, and her muddy cleats found themselves snagged on the high-friction surface beyond it. She tripped, falling forward into a roll. She jumped back to her feet and turned on her heel, hoping to spot her opponent. But she'd been distracted. She made a mistake. She favored her right leg, her injured leg, and so she instinctively turned on that leg. Without the full force of her soul supporting it, twisting her knee like that sent a new surge of pain up the length of her body. Her leg collapsed beneath her and she fell sprawled out on the ground. Jo pleaded silently with her sister to stay down. Opposite her, Lawrence seemed anxious for her to get back up so he could see his ally hurt her even worse. But Monty, once again, waited patiently. He walked to the center of the makeshift arena and picked up his vest, brushed it off, and then put it on before turning once again to face his opponent. It was only then that Jo realized what Monty, with his posh dress and his precise, practiced movements, reminded her of. This entire time, he'd never struck her as a fighter. His movements had just enough flourish to them to draw the eye. When he countered an attack, he always did so at the most dramatic moment. Between that and the nature of his most recent onslaught of techniques, he came off to Jo as something more like an illusionist or stage magician. A stage magician who knew martial arts, but a stage magician nonetheless. Throughout the entire fight, Jo had been grateful that Monty hadn't used much soul, but she'd also wondered why he hadn't. Now she knew. His wand, the bouquet of flowers, the birds, they were his soul manifest in the real world. He could create avatars of his own, but rather than envelop his body in them, he shaped them into implements and stage illusions. It was a power that Jo had never even heard of before, and she could only dream of the possible methods of attack that it offered its wielder. As all of these thoughts swirled around inside Joe's head, Sarah struggled to stand. She had noticed the same thing about Monty's attack, but she hadn't allowed herself to consider what the true scope of his abilities might be. She needed to stay focused. She'd seen Monty attack enough times now that it didn't matter how he attacked. As long as she kept her eyes open, she should be able to see his next technique coming and avoid it. The real question was what she would do once she did. She could barely move with her leg the way it was. Sarah found her footing, though her right leg shook beneath her. If only she could access her life energy, she could mix it with what soul energy she still had and revitalize her soul in an instant, rather than having to wait for it to build up on its own over time. Or better yet, she could cause her life energy to spike instead and curb this pain enough to get herself fully back into the fight. She looked at her hands, and then at the ground beneath her. If she could control life energy, she could use her mother's life from the earth technique to revitalize herself and heal the damage to her leg in an instant. She almost tried it, but then she remembered that her sister was watching, and she stopped herself. Desperate, Sarah ran at Monty as fast as she could with her injury. Monty looked at her with something resembling pity. She struck with her left hand, but Monty sidestepped the attack. She struck with her right hand, still wrapped in her icy knuckles, and Monty leaned back out of her reach just enough that she overreached, stepping harder than she meant to on her injured leg yet again. She doubled over, and Monty lunged forward and kneed her in the ribs. She fell hard to her knees and cried out. Monty frowned at Sarah and said, "You put up a better fight than I thought you would. I'm sorry this had to be drawn out for so long." He spun and delivered a solid kick to the side of Sarah's head. She fell over sideways, unconscious, but before she could collapse fully, she disappeared. Or at least she seemed to. Monty turned to face Joe, who stood in the center of the makeshift arena, holding her sister in her arms. The look that she gave Monty was so fierce that the Soul Taker felt compelled to step back. He was surprised to feel a bead of sweat running down his face. Joe walked silently from the center of the fighting stage back to the sidelines, where Jen and Tucker still lay unmoving. She bent down and placed Sarah very carefully beside them, turned back toward Monty, and appeared right beside him. "Your fight's over," Joe said, "unless you want to take me on too." Monty smiled at her. "No thanks." Without another word, he turned and walked over to stand with his companions. Joe faced Karen next, ignoring the others, and said, "I don't know what you want or why you think you can do this to us, but I'm not about to let this continue. If you're serious about backing off, if we can score just one win, then hurry up and let's get this over with." She was trying to act tough. Out of the corner of her eye, she could see that Monty and Lawrence had bought her act, but she couldn't tell if the same was true of Karen herself. If Karen was intimidated, she didn't show it. And meanwhile, Joe was surprised by just how nervous she was. Her heart was beating faster than she thought possible, and when Karen stepped forward onto the makeshift arena to face her, she had to fight to keep her knees from shaking. "You're powerful," Karen told Joe, her tone conversational, "and I can feel that you have a lot of untapped potential. As you are, though, you simply can't win, not against me." "We'll see about that," Joe countered, and Karen smiled. "If you do manage to win," Karen assured her, "we'll keep our promise. We'll back off. We can't guarantee that we'll never have to return, but we'll leave you for the time being. You may even grow strong enough to offer us a real challenge when we do. And even if I do win, I promise that I'll tell you exactly what we want." Joe knew that she shouldn't trust Karen, but she found herself wanting to. Everything that the lead Soul Taker was saying sounded so genuine. Joe had to remind herself that this person was her enemy, the one who had led Monty and Lawrence against her friends. She was responsible for all of this, at least indirectly. So Joe took a deep breath, and she bore down on the energies flowing through her body. She forced her soul energy to mix with her life energy and seized hold with the entire force of her will of the soul energy that was produced. She wrapped herself in that energy, lighting up the night sky with the light of her wild and churning aura. She put her hands casually in her pockets and met Karen's eyes. Then she disappeared, moving like a shifting shadow.